Thomas Paine. Thomas Paine. Thomas Paine. Sam Adams. Sam Adams. Sam Adams. Benjamin Franklin. Benjamin Franklin. Benjamin Franklin. These men spoke up for what they thought was right. From their courage came such documents as the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution of the United States. From their willingness to speak what was sometimes unpopular but right, we enjoy such liberties as freedom of speech, the right to keep and bear arms, and freedom of religion. There are those who still wish to oppress our freedoms, and there are still patriots willing to stand up and defend life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Men like Zeb Bell, who honor our founding fathers and what they stood for. It's now time for Zeb at the Ranch, speaking up and defending your freedoms. Brought to you by Magic Valley Les Schwab Tire Centers and all of the other great advertisers on the program. And now, Zeb Bell.
I love this story. During a lull between the speeches at the recent White House Correspondents' Dinner, Michelle Obama leaned over to chat with Vice President Joe Biden. She says, "You know, I bought Barack a parrot for his birthday. The bird is so smart. Barack has already taught him to pronounce over 200 words. Wow, that's pretty impressive," says Biden. "But you do realize that he just speaks the words. He doesn't really understand what they mean." "Oh, I know," Michelle replies. "Neither does the parrot." Brump, bump. Good morning. Let's go with Kate Smith and God Bless America on this Wednesday, July the 27th. Good morning. Oh, my goodness sakes. Thank you so much. Zeb at the Ranch, I'm Zeb Bell with our major sponsor, your Magic Valley Les Schwab Tire Centers, all seven locations serving you. Wonderful, wonderful people, and each location ready to help you with safe driving. And don't forget, too, Western Way Services always at your disposal, 734-6969, locally owned and operated. Call and get on the route service today. Right now, without further ado, let's go to our Pledge of Allegiance. Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, how are you, Sunshine Lady?
I'm doing well, thank you. And you? Are you doing better?
Oh, I tell you what, I'm not quite ready for the Olympics 100-yard dash, but we're close.
Good for you. You keep at it.
I will. Thank you, Linda. And give us the pledge, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Oh, you do that so well, along with a great singing of our anthem. God bless you, and have a wonderful summer day.
Thank you. You too.
All right. Thanks, Linda. Thank you so much. There is one of the greatest voices. What a treasure here in this Magic Valley. Thank you, Linda Croft. Appreciate that very much. It is time for the weather on a Wednesday, and it's brought to you by Cheney Flooring and Home Design, 1228 Oakley Avenue in Burley. Look for the blue door. You know, they've got all your carpet and flooring, all your kitchen construction right there through Cheney Flooring and Home Design, all your home decor items, whatever, and I mean this, whatever you need to make your house a home, an individualized, personalized home, they have it at Cheney Flooring and Home Design, 1228 Oakley Avenue in Burley. Look for the blue door. And now here's the lovely Gina with the weather.
Here's a look at your weather as we hit midweek. And honestly, weather's going to be pretty much the same as it has been, sunny and hot. Looking at a high of 95 for today, tonight, low of 58 tomorrow, sunny and 95. Pretty much the same for Friday. Saturday, more clouds will be moving into the area. We do have a slight chance of some thunder bumpers, possibly a rain shower, maybe even a lightning storm. And then looking at highs, possible triple digits for Saturday, overnight low in the mid-60s. Yesterday's high was 93. The overnight low was 53. That is your weather for Zebeth Rain.
Wow, it's going to be warm. Drink a lot of water and maybe even something with it. And have a great day. Thank you very much. Brought to you by Cheney Flooring and Home Design. 1228 Oakley Avenue in Burley. Look for the blue door. Give them a call at 678-6945. Really, really neat people over there at Cheney Flooring and Home Design. Oh, my goodness. I've got so many good things going on today, and I want to share this with you at 10:30 this morning. We are going to have nationally known and renowned spokesperson for, and she's the president of Act for America, and that's Brigitte Gabriel. Now, she's been on my program many, many times in the past. She is, I consider her to be a very good friend. And she, of course, has been on Hannity and O'Reilly and all the news problems. And she is going to address the problem with the Muslim refugees coming into this country, with Obama's edicts and possibly even more with Hillary, if, I hope not, Hillary gets elected. And she's also going to talk about ISIS. She's going to talk about why we're so naive. And she's lived through terrorism and understands it. And we're going to have her on the air at 10:30 this morning. Some other great guests include at 9:06 this morning, we're going to have Dave Bigo from Indianapolis, Indiana on the program. And he knows the vice president hopeful for the Republican Party, and that's Mike Pence. He knows Mike very well. He's going to discuss that. An old friend of ours, Gary Shoresman, is going to be on at 9:30 this morning talking about old farm equipment at the Minidoka County Fair. And Gary, I tell you what, he could take a drip of water and make it sound good and interesting. So he's going to do a great job. And at 10:06, I'm going to have an old friend of mine on the program with me, Jack Euler. And whether you know it or not, you should become aware that the federal government is trying to make more infringements on our use of our public lands. And we're going to talk about that. And then, of course, at 10:30 this morning, Brigitte Gabriel. So calls are welcome and appreciated. 436-22-441-866-927-4587. I want to remind you about Ramsey Heating and Electric at 2600 Overland Avenue in Burley. Now, there's a number I'm going to give you right now in case you want to call ahead and say, please have my air conditioning filters waiting for me on the counter. I've only got a few minutes to get in there, out of there, and home. The number is 678-0459. 678-0459. They open the doors at 7:30 in the morning till 5 Monday through Friday, and they have all your heating and cooling needs right there at Ramsey's. Wonderful people, Ramsey Heating and Electric. You stop in and see them today. I know somebody else, and I was thinking about this yesterday after the program. I've made this statement many, many times on the show that breakfast is my most favorite meal. I mean, fine, you can have a Thanksgiving dinner with turkey. You can have a great big dinner at night or whatever. I love breakfast. And the greatest place to go for me to breakfast is Denny's Restaurant. 611 Overland in Burley and 291 Poline in Twin Falls. I'm telling you, the menu item choices just jump out at you and say, take me, take me. Oh, they're all delicious. At Denny's Restaurant, 611 Overland and Burley with Thomas, Terry, the whole crew. Great service, fantastic food. And Denny's is the home of Zeb's Lunch Bunch. And we'll be looking forward to our next Lunch Bunch in August at Denny's Restaurant. All right, your turn. 436-22-441-866-927-4587. Well, here it is. Hillary's nomination for president by acclamation last night. You know, think about this. And I had a couple of ladies call me yesterday, and they're not happy at all with Hillary as a choice. But what's really worrisome and really scary is that way too many people are going to vote for her just because and only because she's a woman. Really? Really? Are we as a nation that shallow that we're going to vote for somebody just because of a gender? And just because it may be a first in our history? You know, one woman was interviewed yesterday among the many interviews that they're conducting. And she said, I'm going to help write history by voting a woman in as president. And then the interviewer said to this lady, what qualifications does Hillary have to make you vote for her? And the woman said, qualifications are not necessary. Hillary's a woman and a trendsetter. And right there, red flags went right up in the air with me. Wow. Is that really what is going to propel the Democrats? Is that really what's going to propel independents? Is that really what's going to propel the millennials and possibly even the ex-Bernie supporters to vote for a woman because she's a woman with really qualifications that all hinge on illegalities? Are we really in that bad a shape in this country? Hillary's a woman and a trendsetter, so that's what they're going to vote for her for. Oh, my goodness. Give me a call, 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. They say that there are cracks in the glass ceiling, and now with Hillary's nomination, the glass will crumble and she will be a trendsetter. Oh, please. Don't forget Burley Physical Therapy and Rehabilitation at 1263 Bennett Avenue, Suite 2 in Burley. And the number to call, I'm going to give you that right now so you can start dialing, 678-1191. They can help you get back to being and feeling like you. I know that as soon as I'm able to get up, get around, get out of this house, that's what I'm going to start doing, is go back and get my strength back up with Nick and the crew, physical therapist extraordinaire at Burley Physical Therapy and Rehabilitation. That number again, 678-1191. You call them today for an appointment, okay? Take care of it. All right, come on, don't let me down. My audience is the best audience anywhere, anytime, and I want to hear from you. Give me a call. Bubba, Big Bubba Bill, spoke for his quote. This was almost so sickening. With cream cheese on a bagel, when he said, I want you to vote for my best friend and loving wife, Hillary. Oh, I'm telling you, I had indigestion. Caller, good morning, you're on the air.
Good morning, Zeb.
Hello there.
Hey, you know, there is good news.
Oh, really?
You want me to give it to you?
Well, that's why I'm on this program.
Okay. I just wanted to let everybody know that Deanne's flowers and shrubs are safe for the rest of the summer.
Is there an insinuation there, sir? Is there an insinuation there, sir, that perhaps my lawn mower driving abilities might be lessened because of the fact that I have on past occasions maybe made an altered course through some of the rose bushes?
Maybe. This sounds like Hillary.
Be careful. Be careful there, Cottom. Don't go that way.
You know, just stay off that mower for the rest of summer, and everybody and everything will be safe.
Well, I really don't appreciate your remarks whatsoever. Thank you very much.
Now, if we can get a little closer to the truth, because I do know you know how to run that lawnmower.
Yeah.
You know that if you do a bad job, she won't pay you to do it again.
Well, I am very cognizant of the fact that she has done a wonderful job with all of our 937 flower gardens on our front lawn and side lawn. And she is also very cognizant that when the flowers start to droop and die, they are definitely in harm's way, meaning my lawnmower. So it's one or the other. Either keep them live and vibrant, or when they start to droop, I'm going to mow them down.
Well, I think there should be some kind of restriction on you getting any closer to the plants than 10 feet. Well, that gives you a good vision of them, and they're safe.
Let me ask you a question. Since when have I ever denigrated your lawn mowing abilities or yard work to your wife, Nancy? Why are you doing this to me?
Well, because, you know, when you're perfect, you just expect it from others.
Oh, my goodness. All right. All right, Keith. God bless you, man. Thanks for your call. I appreciate it.
I just want to make a comment about Hillary and,
okay,
and what Bill said last night.
It's, okay.
That's pathetic because he built this thing up to where I didn't know where he was going with it. I wasn't interested in his childhood love affairs. But anyway, he built us up to the fact that she completes every job she starts.
Oh, yeah.
She does this and she does that. And it is all a fabrication.
You know, I was almost to the point of having my stomach turn over like a soap opera when he said, well, Hillary and I went for a drive one day, and we found a little bitty White House out in the country, and it was about 1,100 square feet, and Hillary fell in love with the house, and so I bought the house as an incentive for her to marry me. Oh, it kept going, and I kept getting sicker.
I did, too. And, you know, let's take you, for instance. If you were running for a public office or something, your resume is impeccable. I mean, and if they just said what was on that resume, you'd get elected in a heartbeat.
Well...
There's a few bumps along the road that he forgot to tell us
about. Oh, you know, boy, you hit it right there. He left out some chapters of their story, their so-called love affair of being best friends, and he left out all the women that have been involved and all the money scandals. It's funny how that was deleted last night.
Yes, it is. It's a shame that him being as gifted he is at delivering a message, that it was skewed.
Yeah, I agree with you. Keith, God bless you, and thank you very much. I appreciate you, my friend. Thanks.
Stay in the house, please.
I will. All right, thanks. Calls welcome, 436-2244-1, 866-927-4587. You know, basically, and even the pundits... Some of the Democratic pundits last night said that it was Big Bubba Bill's attempt to, and these are their words, not mine, humanize Hillary. Humanize Hillary. I have on my desk, and I'd like to thank some of the folks that help and work for me back in Washington, D.C., and then also New York City. One gentleman in particular, Matt Martini. Matt Martini is a young man that works for a media outlet back on the East Coast, and he does a phenomenal job of supplying me with all the quotations and information regarding to politics, especially with the Clinton campaign. And some of the absolute comments and quotes from Hillary... From Hillary to her staff and others in politics are so degrading and so absolutely vile and filthy. I can't, on the air, I can't even relate the quotes that are in print form. I wouldn't do it. I mean, there are so many stories about her yelling and screaming and cursing at people. There are so many stories about her using racist comments. And she's not a nice lady. She is not a nice lady. And that exterior of, well, this is my best friend and my loving wife, Hillary. Why, we've been married since the early 70s, and we're just as happy walking along and talking and smiling as we ever were. That's bogus. That's bogus. And... it was an attempt last night, and I know a lot of you folks out in the audience are sitting there going, well, Zeb, you are prejudiced. You are a conservative. You are a Republican. And so naturally, you're going to pick apart everything that Big Bubba said last night about his loving wife. No, I got to be truthful. The speech stunk. I can't put it together any other way. It was nothing more than kind of like reading a diary out of a love affair that you want to believe. That you want to believe. But when it came to the parts about, well, I haven't refound this 1,100 square foot beautiful little white home with a porch. You know, I know I'm being cynical. But it was nothing more than a jaded attempt to make the general public, and the Democrats lapped it up like it was ice cream last night. It was nothing more than an attempt to put her in a different persona. She is a very vile, outspoken, at many times hateful individual that doesn't like people. Give me a call, 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. While I'm waiting for your call that I certainly hope comes in, I got too many friends to have the phones be quiet. Come on, give me a call. Berry Equipment and Rental, and they've got three locations, South Lincoln in Jerome and Addison Avenue West in Twin Falls and 159 West Highway 30 in Burley. And for all your equipment rentals, need some equipment to do a job? Bingo, go to Berry Equipment and Rental. You want to buy some equipment to keep it right there on your place and have it there so when you need it, you got it, you can get the job done? Bingo, right there at Berry Equipment and Rental. And if your equipment needs any service work or parts, bingo, right there, Berry Equipment and Rental. Jerome, Twin Falls, and 159 West Highway 30 in Burley. Berry Equipment and Rental serving you. Oh, there you go. Now we crack the ice and we're going to fall through. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Hi, Zeb.
Hi there.
Hey, I just had a comment about, I didn't watch all of that Democratic convention last night, that a comment that Michelle Obama made really offended me, and it was, she said something about she wakes up every morning in a house that was built by slaves.
Ooh.
And that just led into the endorsement of Hillary and how women can be anything they want to be. That statement just really offended me.
Let me ask you a question, and I'm so glad you called. But when it comes to voting for Hillary, just because she's a woman, or just because it would be a first in American history, is that really the reason that you think a lot of women are going to vote for Hillary? Isn't that a little bit shallow?
I think so. She's not qualified, I don't believe. So I think you need to look at that first. You know, Obama was our first black president, and look where that got us.
Well,
so, I mean, I don't think you should just vote for somebody based on male, female, black, white, whatever. We got to look at the qualifications.
Let me ask you a question now. How long have you followed politics? 10 years, 20 years, whatever? How long have you really kind of followed it?
Probably the last 10 years.
Okay, good. Good. You can answer this question then. I was on the air 8 years ago prior to Obama's being elected, and I went through hell with the local Times News and others that called me a racist because I was against Barack Obama. That's right away what they came out in the paper and everything else and called me a racist. But at the same time, my dear lady, I was advocating, if you were listening to this program then, I was advocating that Condoleezza Rice run for president on the Republican ticket, and she is black. So why is there a double standard?
I don't know. I don't have any idea, but I don't know. I'm worried. I'm afraid Hillary's going to get it, and I certainly don't want that, but...
What is your biggest fear?
I don't know where we're headed.
What is your biggest fear of Hillary?
I don't think she's truthful. I don't think she's honest in anything she says, anything she does. The whole Benghazi thing, I just don't like her, and I don't like how she comes across to the American people, and... I don't like her.
Well, you know, in my fear, I go right along with everything you said, but there's one other item I'd like to throw in and get your quick comment on. I am afraid of the first gentleman, which would be Bubba Bill, in the White House with Hillary, and we're going to see the same scandals, the same kind of money problems, everything else. That scares me.
Yeah, I agree.
Oh, God bless you for your call.
And I don't understand how she was even able to run for president while being under investigation.
Amen.
I don't even understand how that was even allowed.
Amen. Thank you so much for your call this morning. And call again. I've enjoyed talking to you.
Yes, you too. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. Got to get a word in, then I take some more calls, 436-2244. And my sergeant-at-arms, Deanne, is standing here going, are you going to stand up? Well, I'm going to try. If I get time, I promise I will. If not, it'll be at the 9 o'clock hour. She does such a wonderful job helping me. God bless Deanne. That's what I mean that. Don't forget Mount Harrison Audiology and Hearing Aids with the lovely Dr. Christine Pickup. And they're located right across from the Minidoka Hospital Emergency Room, and the number to call for a hearing screening to find out what you're missing is 312-0957. Don't sit there at those parties and birthday gatherings and everything. What'd they say, Martha? No. Get in there and find out what the problem is with hearing loss at Mount Harrison Audiology and Hearing Aids, 312-0957. And by the way, on Mondays, we always give away some great, great either cinnamon rolls or cookies from Sophie's Chatterbox at 530 East Street in Rupert. Oh, what a great place to go eat in their restaurant. Oh, what a great bakery. You're going to love the food always. I do at Sophie's Chatterbox in Rupert. You stop over and say hello to those good folks today. All right, calls are welcome, 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. Yeah, the whole speech by Bill Clinton last night, I know the Democrats out there, their hands are on the steering wheel and they're white and they're gnashing their teeth right now and they're hating me. But the whole thing was just to change the entire persona of what really and who really Hillary is. And like I said, to try to humanize her. And there was something else last night that I really would appreciate your comments on. I know I'm being picky. I said that earlier. But I thought it was almost despicable that the Democratic National Convention would feature on stage at their convention mothers that had lost their sons due to a shooting and shootouts with police. Now, here's why. I feel sorry, a deep sympathy for any parent that loses a child. Oh, that's got to be, and I'm so glad I haven't gone through it, but my heart goes out to people that have. But when a crime is being committed, when a criminal activity is being committed, and we basically say, oh, well, yeah, sure, they were stealing a car. Oh, yeah, sure, they were doing this with drugs or something else. Or, oh, yeah, sure, they were beating somebody else up. But the police shouldn't have shot my son. And the Democrats put them on stage and highlight them. Why not? And you've heard this, I'm sure. Why not also put the wives and the mothers and the children of police officers up on the stage? Maybe even together. Maybe even together so that all lives matter. I got to tell you that never on this program, will I ever succumb to respecting the organization called Black Lives Matter. I don't care if some of the people are trying to soft sell this thing right now nationwide and say, well, you know, they meant that Black Lives Matter right along with brown lives and white lives and everything. That's what they meant. No, come on, don't go there. The group started as a hate group. The group started as thugs and punks invading libraries, taking over space, absolutely being thugs. And you're not going to sell it to me. I find it despicable that they would honor or try to honor the mothers of, and it's very unfortunate, their sons were shot and killed by police officers, but let's analyze really what happened. Okay, son Johnny, what was he doing? Oh, Well, he was he stabbed somebody with a knife, and then he reached in his pocket and pulled out a gun, and the police shot him. Oh, those bad, bad police. You see, you got to look at every single story, and you've got to analyze what happened. The police have only thousandths of a second to make a decision to draw their weapon and protect themselves and also protect the rest of society. And literally, they are damned if they do or don't. And Monday on the program, that kind of brings me to mind that I called Sheriff Eric Snar from Minidoka County, and I want him to come on the air and talk about Blue Lives Matter. And also, why people in this area are so naive thinking that many of the same problems that happen in the inner city can also happen here. But to feature the mothers, and I know it was a very, very tear-jerking and sad occasion to hear those moms on the microphone about talking about their sons and everything, but not once did they really highlight, hey, why was Johnny or Freddie or Jimmy or whatever, why were they involved in an activity that maybe would have created an atmosphere where the police had to take charge and unfortunately use their weapons? Those are the things that the media kind of overlooks and overshadows. Calls are welcome, 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. Hey, we had a ripping good conversation yesterday with a really nice guy over there at the Minidoka County Fair. Holy moly, I mean, that was fun. Greg was on the phone with us, and we just had a ball. He is really enthusiastic. Greg Walton. And the Minidoka County Fair starting on August 1st, going through the 6th, and it's at the Minidoka County Fairgrounds over in Rupert. They're going to have all kinds of fun things, lawnmower races and Dutch oven cobbler free to the public, and they're going to have concerts, and they're going to have team sorting and rodeos and all the exhibits. And wow, it's going to be fun. And an added attraction this year, the old farm equipment, both power and steam, and Gary Shoresman is heading up that display. Minidoka County Fair and Rodeo, August 1st through the 6th at the Minidoka County Fairgrounds in Rupert. Don't you miss it. Going to be a good one. Don't you forget to call 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. I had to kind of chuckle as I was reviewing the news last night and again today. When I got out of bed, you know what? I got to tell you, my habits have changed in the morning. Ever since I had the surgery, I'm slowed down from trying to go 90 miles an hour to get things done and get up early in the morning and get all my interviews and all my people lined up and all the phone numbers and the information and everything. And we aren't getting up as early as we used to. We get up now, instead of 4:15, we're getting up at about 10 minutes to 5. And by the time I get my old fat body, I get dressed and I get around slowly, it's almost time to get on the radio. But I got to tell you that I was really interested in a story that came out yesterday with Geraldo Rivera. Now, he works for Fox News now, and Geraldo has been a reporter in the news business for a long, long time. Used to be a talk show host and everything else. But Geraldo was out on the street yesterday in Philadelphia, pardon me, and he was interviewing some of the protesters, some of the Bernie protesters, and there were the Black Lives Matter protesters out there. That was a bunch of angry people. Middle of the day, and none of them evidently had jobs, or they had a real long lunch hour, and he gets over to by this one guy, and they're talking back and forth, and this black guy's kind of ridiculing Fox and saying they're bad, this, that, and the other, and in credit to Geraldo, he stood there and he took it, listened, let the man speak, but while he's talking to this guy, somebody else from behind Geraldo comes up and dumps a great big bottle of water on his head. Now, Geraldo is not a big guy. Okay, he's about 73 or 74 years old. But immediately, without even any hesitation, Geraldo whips around, and I mean, he's into the crowd, and he is going to lap up that guy like a puppy dog. He is mad. And he had to be held back by security guards for thumping the guy that poured the water all over him. And I mean to tell you, he had that microphone in his hand, and it was not going to be used for an interview. And you know what? I respect him for that. The news media is, they've got a job to do. They've got to go out there and they've got to ask questions, and they're trying to find out the heart of the matter, and they're trying to find out why people are upset, and they're trying to find out why they're protesting. They're trying to find out really what their grievances are. They're trying to find out what they stand up for. And then they have some of these pond scums come up and cause problems. You're doggone right. I'm on the side of the reporter saying, listen, bubba, you want to have a good knuckle sandwich, do that again. I respect Geraldo for defending himself and going after the guy. Come on, give me a call, 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. Wake up time! Somebody give me a call right now, and I'd also, while I'm waiting for your call, I'd like to talk to you a little bit about Minnecasha Sales, 1321 East Main Street in Burley. Zach and the rest of the crew. Oh, these are nice people. Oh, they've got all the products you need to really, if you're doing some remodeling, rebuilding, whatever, wow, this is the place to go. They've got all your lumber packages. They've got all your roofing material. They've got all your shingles, metal or asphalt. And they've got the Great Western windows. And they've got all the Tartar Farm and Ranch gates and panels. Holy buckets, they've got it all. Stop in. See them today. Really, really good people at Minnecasha Sales, 1321 East Main Street in Burley, right across from the airport. Or give them a call at 878-2091. Oh, my goodness. Come on. Get on the line. 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. Oh, by the way, the Democrats must have got the memo about the flags. It was turning into, yesterday afternoon, a big national story. Honestly, there were a lot of commentators that got on their programs and said, well, wait a minute, Democrats, where's the flags? Well, they're going to be coming out tonight. Or, oh, yeah, we'll get them up tomorrow. Excuse me, we'll get them up tomorrow or whatever the case might be. Almost like it was an afterthought. Maybe it was. But somebody got the memo. And some of the Democratic leadership, and there are some really good guys and gals that are, let's say, fair enough to look at things impartially and give an honest answer. And I believe, I don't want to say the wrong name here because if I make a mistake, somebody will jump all over me, but I think it was Joe Trippi with the Democrats that said to the effect, oh, they made a bad mistake. And that's something that should not have been overlooked. And along with the email scandals and the Democrats acting like they are about elitists and racist in some of these emails, and then not having the United States flags all over for the Democratic National Convention the first day, they really didn't put their best foot forward. All right, calls are welcome, 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. UrgentCareOfIdaho.com. Let me say it again, the website, UrgentCareOfIdaho.com. Wow, three locations to serve you. Riverview Urgent Care at 382 North Overland in Burley. Twin Falls Urgent Care at 2392 Addison Avenue East in Twin Falls. And Jerome Urgent Care at 133 West Avenue A in Jerome. Minor emergencies, major care. No appointments necessary. Quicker, less expensive. What are you waiting for? Stop into the Urgent Cares today. Right now, here's Gina with the weather.
Here's a look at your weather as we hit midweek. And honestly, weather's going to be pretty much the same as it has been, sunny and hot. Looking at a high of 95 for today, tonight, low of 58 tomorrow, sunny and 95. Pretty much the same for Friday. Saturday, more clouds will be moving into the area. We do have a slight chance of some thunder bumpers, possibly a rain shower, maybe even a lightning storm. And then looking at highs, possible triple digits for Saturday, overnight low in the mid-60s. Yesterday's high was 93. The overnight low was 53. That is your weather for Zebit the Rain.
Oh, she does a great job. Thank you very much. Riverview Urgent Care. Urgent Care of Jerome and Twin Falls Urgent Care. Thank you, Kyle James, and all the staff. Minor emergencies, major care. No appointments necessary. You stop in and see them today. All right, your turn. Excuse me, I still got that doggone cough. 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. This almost makes me want to cry this morning, seriously. The absolute vermin. I don't know how many words are in the English dictionary to describe my hatred and my complete disdain for ISIS and Al-Qaeda and terrorism in general. What they did, they being ISIS, with two teenage recruits over in France, you think that it can't get more disgusting and vile. And then all of a sudden that story comes out of France yesterday. About during a Catholic church service where two teenage ISIS recruits walked into this church and slit the throat of the priest. And our government, Obama and this administration, they just kind of shine this problem off? Caller, good morning. You're on the air.
Good morning again, Zeb. Something on my mind about Hillary that I just want to put out there, and that's how she tells about how she's going to fix everything: free college, no tuition, and we're going to build new bridges, new tunnels, all freeways, and everything. And also for you old folks, we're going to increase your Social Security and give you better Medicare benefits and everything. She did this all in one paragraph.
Yeah.
Now, if you started something, if you wanted to do something at your house, like you wanted to build onto it, and you just said, this is what we're going to do, Deanne. We're going to build this room on there, especially for my studio, and we're all ready to go. And then Deanne says, what are we going to pay for it with?
Yep.
We won't worry about that. We'll pay later.
Yeah.
And that's the problem we have with a $19 trillion deficit. We can talk about all these things. And that's one thing about Donald Trump. He does come out and say he has a plan before he starts giving all this stuff away.
Well, and somebody's got to pay for it, because there's no such thing as a free lunch, and that goes into wide areas of conversation. But I absolutely am. I find it appalling that she can come out with a tax plan that's going to raise taxes for everybody and hurt everybody financially, and the Democrats never talk about that. Keith, I've got one other call waiting, and then I've got to get a commercial in, my dear friend. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you. Caller, go ahead. You're on the air. Thank you.
I just have a quick comment. Not only were there no flags up on the platform, but there apparently were none in the delegates or audience, whatever, except for one flag, and that was a Palestinian flag.
Yes.
And that's my comment.
No, wait a minute. Don't hang up, because what were your thoughts? What were your thoughts if you watched the convention and the start of the convention with all the disarray because of the Bernie supporters, and when they were doing the invocation, the prayer, there was interruptions and boos? I find, and I'm going to say this, and correct me if you think I'm wrong, but I found the Democratic National Convention so far to be basically an anti-American value system, to where they've got their own platform and they don't care about traditional values in this country.
Oh, I totally agree with you, Zeb. Absolutely. I felt that way right from the beginning when she first said it, that if I could even stand to listen to her.
Well, I appreciate your call as always. God bless you and thank you.
Thank you. The same to you.
All right. Thank you very much. Yeah, I sat there, and I've listened and try to be fair and honest about this, but oh, my goodness, some of these brain-dim-wit actors and singers out of Hollywood and out of general entertainment standing up there, well, I think you should do this. They don't know. I don't know why it is, and I've said this so many times, it's old on this program, but I have been blessed. I've been in about 6 movies, and I've done some voiceover work for others. And I've been around these people, and when I say these people, I'm talking about actors in Hollywood. Why is it that when they get a star put next to their name, oh, so-and-so was the star of this movie, that their intelligence supposedly goes up to the highest level? It does not. These people are told where to stand. They are given the lines of what to say. They're told how to move, what to do. They're like little human robots. But then all of a sudden, when they're in a great big movie that makes success, whether it's a Spielberg movie or whatever, oh, well, so-and-so is so smart, we've got to have them speak at our convention because they know all about world politics. They don't know a doggone thing. Calm me down, caller. Good morning.
Yeah, you know, when since this Democratic National Convention has convened, what I've heard of it, which is nothing new, but you say to yourself, they're so full of BS. They are so full of it. And you say to yourself, who in the hell believes any of this? And you say, well, if there's 47% of the country is going to vote for this witch from hell, and you say, Karl Marx had a term, they're useful idiots. But you see, then you vast arrays of different definitions of what they are. But you see, you say to yourself, how long will they be this way, and will they ever change? Or are we just literally going to have to live with 47% of the country, and maybe more, being this absolutely stupid?
You know, Randy, I think that it is your fault. I think it's my fault. I think it's a lot of people's faults that we have allowed this to go on in this country with our education system, and our churches aren't standing up and saying enough and doing enough. Our whole society is at fault for allowing this crisis to occur in our society, to where our Constitution isn't valued, our Christianity isn't valued, our family and moral values aren't valued. It's our fault because we didn't stand up a long time ago and say, stop!
Well, okay, one quick point, and then I know I gotta go. There was a time when this president named Clinton, and he stood there before us, and he had a crooked finger. And he pointed at us, he says, I did not have sex with that woman. And he was a bold-faced, lying, you know what. And you see what happened. He looked like he was close to being hung, lynched, as he needed to be. And then he got away with it.
I agree.
And see, what that did, not only did it set a precedent for family dysfunctionality, but it also set a precedent for elected officials getting away with just, in some cases, maybe murder.
I agree with you. I agree with you. Randy, thank you as always. I appreciate it, buddy. Thanks. Good point right there. I want to remind everybody, too, about our Magic Valley Les Schwab Tire Centers, all 7 locations, summer travel time, touring and driving and going to see Aunt Martha and Uncle Fred, and she pinches your cheek and says, oh, it's so good to see you. And they've got all the tires, I mean, my goodness, for your car, your pickups, your SUVs, all your trailers. Lane and Rupert, Dave on Blue Lakes and Twin, Mike and Buell, Mike and Jerome, the Twist family in Paul, Daniel on Poleline in Twin Falls, and Randy on Overland and Burley. Oh, Oh, the brakes aren't working that good, huh? You put your foot on the brake the other day and, whoa, almost cruised right through that stop sign. Well, you'd better get in right now to your Magic Valley Les Schwab Tire Centers, and they have the best doggone professionally trained technicians, and they can take care of your brakes. Stop in today. They are the best with the tires and, of course, the front end alignments, the brake service, the shocks and the struts, the batteries, the list goes on. Great service at your Magic Valley Les Schwab Tire Centers. You stop in and see them today. Okay, next hour, my buddy Dave Bigo. Should be very, very interesting because he's going to give us some personal insight as to his knowing personally vice presidential candidate for the Republican ticket, Mike Pence. And then at 9:30, my dear, dear friend Gary Shoresman. I understand Gary's going to be at the studio, and we're going to talk about the old farm equipment at the Minidoka County Fair. Jack Euler at 10:06, Brigitte Gabriel. Don't miss it at 10:30 right here on Zebeth Ranch. I'll be back in about 6 minutes. Oh my, here we go, hour number two on a Wednesday, July 27th, Zeb at the Ranch. I'm Zeb Bell with our major sponsor, your Magic Valley Les Schwab Tire Centers, all seven locations serving you and doing a great job, and of course some of our great advertisers like Western Waste Services.
From the canyons of the Snake River and all across southern Idaho.
The problems you don't want to mess with. You're garbage. Oh, my goodness. Call and get on the route service today and stand there at the back door and watch your garbage get out of there. By golly, they're good. Western Waste Services always at your disposal. Call 734-6969. Locally owned and operated and serving you, always at your disposal, Western Waste Services. By the way, too, don't forget Cheney Flooring and Home Design. They sponsor our weather every morning at 8:06 right here on Zeb at the Ranch. Thank you, thank you. Carpet flooring, kitchen construction, home decor items, yep, the best. At Cheney Flooring and Home Design, 1228 Oakley Avenue in Burley. Look for the blue door. A very dear friend. We have never shaken hands and met anybody, eyeball to eyeball, but I'm in hock to him for about 973 bottles of wine and wagers that I've lost, and I have nothing but the utmost respect for this man. Good morning, Indianapolis, Indiana. Dave Bigo, how are you?
I'm doing great, Zeb. I'm glad you're back on the air, and I'm glad you're doing well. And just as a side note, I think it's 975 bottles of wine.
On the wall, what would happen if one should fall? Okay, let's get right to it, because I know we've got to abbreviate some of our interview this morning. You've got a meeting to go to, a very important meeting. Mike Pence, in your opinion, because you know the man, he's from your home state of Indiana, was he and is he a good choice for the Republican vice president?
Well, Zeb, I like Mike Pence. I've known him a long time because I first met him in Washington when I was fighting the SEIU and then the Employee Free Choice Act, which the unions were trying to pass the bill for the Portion Unionized People employees, you know. And, you know, Mike, if you meet him, he comes across as a very nice gentleman, even-keeled, even-spoken type of individual. Much as he's the polar opposite of Donald Trump, okay? And I think that's probably one of the biggest reasons he was chosen, because when he talks, you could tell he puts thought into it. He just doesn't go off the cuff and say things that he shouldn't say. And I think that from that standpoint, he will be a good partner for Trump. Now, having said that, one thing is... Sometimes I think he is maybe a little bit too polar opposite. He's a little bit too much withdrawn. He needs to get out and be a little more aggressive. But we'll see how that goes during the campaign.
Well, that was my question next. I was going to ask you, do you think that Mike Pence is dynamic enough? Do you think that Mike Pence can assert himself and his ideas into a conversation with somebody that is really kind of a one-man band like Trump? Can he do it?
Well, I think he can. You know, I think it depends on who it is he's dealing with and talking with. You know, he used to, I don't know if you know or your listeners know, he used to be a talk show host.
Really?
Years ago.
Oh. Okay, I did not know that.
In Indiana, I think he was on the air for 10 or 12 years. And before that, he was a Democrat, by the way. You know, he got conversion, and he's moved over, and he does know how to talk to people. He does know how to convince them. I think the big thing is taking the initiative to do so. He tends to be a little bit of a type manager where he delegates a lot. And, you know, that's fine if you follow up and know that there's times where you personally have to get in front of some of these people and sit down and talk to them and debate them. And hopefully he'll step up and do that kind of stuff because, again, I've met him many times, and I've been at events where he's at and when he's spoken, and he speaks from the heart. And one thing I like about him, Zeb, unlike Obama, he doesn't need a teleprompter. He's got the ideas in his head, and he knows how to click them off and talk about them, and he doesn't need a bunch of papers in front of him, so he's always looking out at the audience, which I think is important.
I agree.
When you're addressing people.
I agree, totally. Let me ask you this. I'm going to kind of put you on the spot a little bit. When you look at the two tickets right now that are ready and available for the public to scrutinize, and you look at Mike Pence and Donald Trump, and you look at Tim Kaine and Hillary, what would you define as good points, bad points, and really, who has the edge?
Well, I think the edge depends on a lot. I think Trump has the upper hand, and Pence does. If Trump cleans up his act and, you know, isn't off the cuff, I mean, he's gone back to that the last few days and talking about the Democratic National Convention, and he's gotten a little wild again. And I'm disappointed because during the Republican convention, if you heard him talk, he was very polished,
yes.
Much more professional.
Yes.
And that's the way he has to stay. You just have to expose these people and their misinformation and their lies and all that kind of stuff and do it in a professional way so that they stand there and stutter when they have to debate you. And if he would do it that way, I think he's got the upper hand because I think he'll have Hillary stuttering.
Let me ask you this question, and I've done some follow-up and some research on this, so I consider my sources to be correct. But Tim Kaine on the Democratic side for vice president under Hillary scares me because of some of the ties, some of the relationships, etc., with the Muslim Brotherhood and a coddling, if you will, to Muslim influences in this country. That scares me. What about you?
Well, it absolutely does, and I think this is a place where Pence and Trump can go after him and, you know, talk to him about the fact that, you know, we got to protect America and we got to make America safe again, and we're a nation of laws, and we got to abide by those laws. That doesn't mean that we're against people of Islam faith or any anybody else in the world, but they have to abide by our laws, and they have to go through our system, and if they do that, then they have the opportunity to become citizens here in this country. But we just can't open our borders and let people flood across. And by the way, that's one place that Pence does have a little bit of a problem because, you know, he shut down Indiana as far as refugees coming into the state. And the Catholic Church has been after him about that because they actually funded, especially the Archdiocese here in Indianapolis, funded a family coming in. And, you know, Pence has been pushing back against that. So he's got a little bit of a feud going on there.
Okay. Now, Dave, I watched because I was basically held captive in my house because of my surgery, but I watched every single aspect of the Republican National Convention. And quite frankly, and I'm trying to be fair and balanced, they had some flaws, they had some loopholes that never did get connected, but in general, I thought it was uplifting, I thought it was informative, I thought that it was positive, I thought that it was talking about making this country even greater when we've been on the decline for the last 8 to 10 years. I thought it was a good convention. Then, the first day of the Democratic Convention, no American flags up on the stage, everything was just kind of helter-skelter. The Bernie supporters were mad. Give me your comparison as to the two conventions.
Well, I agree with you 100%. I think the Republican convention was much more professional, much more polished, much more informative, and much more presidential. And I think the DNC, I think their true colors have shown through the last few days, and will continue to do so. Unfortunately, and this is a thing that Trump and Pence are going to have to deal with, is the mainstream media is going to try and paint these things in different colors so the DNC looks better. But this is the opportunity for Trump, and not to do it in ways, his tweeting and his stuff like that, where he uses some off-color words and statements to come out and say, you know, we are not a party that didn't have American flags on our platform or burning them in the streets. We are a party for America, and we need all Americans, and we want all Americans, whether you're black, white, yellow, you know, Hispanic, whatever your religious background is, as long as you're good people and you understand and obey the laws of our Constitution.
Dave, I got to tell you that last night they introduced Big Bubba, Bill Clinton. He stepped up to the podium and he gave me what I considered to be kind of a nauseating speech of walking down memory lane and talking about how he found his best friend and his lover and Hillary Clinton, and talked about the little White House in Arkansas, and oh, it was just all peaches and cream and turned my stomach. What did you think about Bill's attempt to humanize Hillary?
Well, you know, I just read some of that this morning. I didn't, I'll be honest, didn't make it up late enough to watch his speech. I wish I would have, just so I could have seen his gestures and emotion and stuff like that. But, you know, I think people have to take a step back and then look at Bill Clinton and the things he said, and look back who Bill Clinton himself is and what his lifestyle has been and what his morals are. And that paints the real picture.
Final thought here on the Clintons, though, and you as a businessman. You know, if Hillary does win, God forbid, and Bill becomes the first gentleman of the White House, aren't we going to revert right back to the Clintonian age of all these scandals, all the money problems, all the different personnel problems? I don't want to have another 4 years, and heaven forbid, possibly eight, with the same family being in power.
Well, I agree with you 100%, and that's what we have, and, you know, what they need to talk about and point out, I think, with Hillary is her incompetence. I mean, she couldn't even handle things that were going on in Benghazi when that happened, and, you know, the emails and everything else. I mean, even her first job, she didn't make it through very long in the private sector. And I think you have to point out to the American people, this isn't about attacking people, or this isn't about throwing out barbs or anything. This is about, do these people truly have the qualifications, and is the information that they're supplying to the American people truthful information, and can they make this country great again, as Trump says? And they can sit there all day like Hillary has. So, well, America's still great. We haven't really gone downwards. The truth is we have, and the whole world sees that, and I think we need to stay on that note.
Yeah, real quick, short answer on this so I can get you out of here on time. When Michelle Obama got up there, she basically chastised us for thinking that this country has slipped a little bit and gone in reverse. I didn't like being chastised, because you can pick up the newspaper, you can listen to the news, and I have the truth on my program. We have slipped as a nation because of the lower standards.
Oh, there's no doubt about it, and our economy is continuing to sag. I mean, we're seeing it every day in business with customers that we do business with, and, you know, we do business with Fortune 500 companies down to smaller companies, and everybody is concerned about the economy and where things are going, and you know, the truth is that this administration has not done anything for the American people. They've done everything for themselves and their own beliefs, which are not the American way.
You know what? It is exactly, I mean, right spot on, 20 minutes after the hour, and you're out of here, man. Congratulations, and thanks, Dave Beagle, for being on the program again this week.
Well, thank you. I'm glad you're healthy, and it's good to have you back.
Oh, God bless you. 975 bottles of wine on the wall. Dun, 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 dun. Thank you, Dave Beagle.
Thanks a lot. Take care, Dave.
All right, buddy. Thanks a lot. Oh, I love talking to him back in Indianapolis, Indiana. Dave Beagle, a really, really big and very successful businessman and entrepreneur. And he's written quite a few books and has a weekly blog. I really respect him. And he's a fairly close friend of Mike Pence, the vice presidential pick for Donald Trump. Calls are welcome, 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. Don't forget our friends, your friends, at Hanson Mortuary, 710 6th Street in Rupert. Joel Heward, his family, the staff, all of them giving you and your family the attention necessary when there's the passing of a loved one. What a tumultuous time. What a time where you're just so worried about getting everything done. Stop right there. Take a big breath and call 436-5636. They can and will help you with the highest ethical standards with unquestioned integrity. Hanson Mortuary, 710 6th Street in Rupert, 436-5636. Oh, we got a lot of things cooking, and at 9:30 this morning, we're going to have Gary Shoresman on the program, and Gary is going to be talking about old farm equipment at the Minidoka County Fair. By the way, come on, give me a call. My wife and I, excuse me, I got a frog in my throat. Get back in the swamp. My wife and I were talking during the 9 o'clock break. My goodness, are we sleeping in this morning? Give me a call, 436-2244. Minidoka County Fair and Rodeo is going to take place August 1st through the 6th at the Minidoka County Fairgrounds in Rupert. And holy cow, Greg was on yesterday. There's a man that I love his enthusiasm. He was talking about the rodeo. He was talking about the junior rodeo. He was talking about the concert. He was talking about the Dutch oven cobbler and ice cream on Wednesday night that's free. Oh my! And the lawnmower races and the gymkhanas and the team sorting and the displays and the booths and the food. Booths. B-O-O-T-H-S. I didn't say the other word. It's going to be a lot of fun at your Minidoka County Fair and Rodeo, August 1st through the 6th. You be there. Going to be a lot of fun. I mentioned to you, excuse me, I apologize for this bad throat. I mentioned to you that Brigitte Gabriel is going to be on the phone with us at 10:30 this morning, and she is also going to be speaking in Twin Falls on August 4th at 7 p.m. at the Roper Auditorium on Filer Avenue in Twin Falls. And this woman is just phenomenal. And I trust her. I trust her integrity. I trust her knowledge on what's going on with terrorism and the Muslim problem in the world today. And I urge you, strongly urge you, to take the time to go to that meeting at 7 p.m. at the Roper Auditorium on August 4th. I would love to be there. Somebody's going to say, well, are you going to be there? Well, I can't. I can't right now. Go out in public and take a risk of being maybe bumped into and taking a spill on this hip. And it hurts me really bad that I can't be there because Brigitte has been a friend of mine for years and years. And she's been on all the top talk shows across the nation, Hannity, O'Reilly, you name it, she's been there. And so knowledgeable. And it really does pain me not to be able to be there on August 4th at 7 p.m., but you can go in my stead, and I hope you do. Gina gave me, over at the station, she sent over a story that, I don't know if you're aware of it or not, but the Green Bay Packers football team is literally owned by the entire city, all the population, I mean, all they're all owners and stockholders. And she sent me a really kind of an interesting story that the Green Bay Packers are going to open up a brand new bacon-centric concession stand at the Lambeau Field. And everything that they sell at this concession stand is going to be wrapped in bacon. Bacon, bacon, bacon. And they're going to have the pigskin, a bacon-wrapped baked potato topped with chili, chopped bacon, cheddar cheese, sour cream, and chives, and bacon-crusted cheese curds with a side of bacon ranch dressing. That's something that, boy, on those cold November, December days back at Lambeau Field, when the snow is falling and the winds are howling and that little bitty temperature deal at the end of the stadium, that gives you all the awareness as to how cold it is. I never will forget going to games up at the old Green Bay Packer Field in Green Bay years ago when I was still in high school. And you'd look over there and the temperature would say minus 15 degrees. And you're sitting there wrapped in every blanket that you stole from every bed in your house. You've got your fur-lined mucklucks on and about 97 pairs of gloves. You've got 37 stocking caps on. And you're afraid to drink a whole bunch of hot chocolate or whatever for obvious reasons. And there you are, sitting for four quarters at the coldest game in the world. But it's worth it. Man, those old days with Bart Starr and Jim Taylor, Paul Hornung, Max McGee. Those were my idols when I grew up. And I knew a lot of them. Jerry Kramer. Excuse me. Jerry Kramer was on this program many, many times the last couple of years talking about the old Green Bay Packers. And we used to have a lot of fun going to those games. And I went to one game that they had at Milwaukee County Stadium. And it was the game between the Minnesota Vikings and the Green Bay Packers at the old Milwaukee County Stadium where the Atlanta Braves used to play. And the temperature when we got to the stadium and got out of the car was minus 5. And it was about 5 minutes to 12 Central Time. And when we left the stadium that night and taking very short steps because we were afraid our kneecaps would break in two, we were so cold. It was down to minus 27 degrees. 27 below. And it gets cold at some of those Packer games, but oh, there is a lot of fun. Now they're going to open up a brand new bacon restaurant at Lambeau Field. Calls are welcome, 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. While I have a minute, would you allow me to take a sip of ice water? Excuse me. That's better. Let's ride 270 Highway 24 between Rupert and the World with their summer hours open Monday through Saturday, 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. And you know what? I told you the other day that they are really getting some great, great prices on the 2016 models, much more economical to you because the 2017 models are coming in. And on Suzuki, 0% financing. Wow. And they've got all the accessories. And they've got, of course, a great service department. All you have to do is stop over and see them at 270 Highway 24 between Rupert and the entire world. Let's ride. Where the fun is sold. Really good, folks. Do I have any other public service announcements right here today? I don't think so. I will mention that tomorrow on the program, at 10:30 tomorrow morning, as a matter of fact, we're going to have Sharon Hardy Mills back on the show. And she is going to go on a handcart excursion across the West, and she's going to be pulling and pushing one of those handcarts up and down the mountains in tribute to her, I think she said, her great, great, great grandmother. And she's going to tell us a little bit about that tomorrow morning on the program. Right now, without further ado, let us move over to the main studios of KBAR. And in the studio, and getting very close to the microphone, we hope, so I can hear his dulcet tones, here is the one, the only, Gary Shoresman. Good morning, Gary. How are you?
Dulcet tones?
Well, something like that.
How do you spell that?
D-U-L-C-E-T.
Oh, those, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Good morning. Yes, great. Fair time.
I need Wheels to turn you up a little bit in my headset because I don't want to miss any of your dulcet tones.
In the diatribe that I have prepared.
There you go. Gary, what is this that my wife gave me the note, and she said that at the Minidoka County Fair this year, August 1st through the 6th, you are kind of quarterbacking the old farm equipment display.
I am. For 15 years, I've run the antique building, county fair, and so kind of along with that, and also having been chair of the Minidoka County Centennial back in 13, John Remsburg and myself got to be reacquainted and good friends and had a lot of his old 100-year-old horse and steam-powered engines and machinery. Entered not only in the fair, but we did a power show then and at the fairgrounds, and it was very well received. And John, like myself, is sort of a passion for both of us because we remember a lot of those machines, and 50 years ago we were closer to them when they were a little newer, but 50 years later today, a lot of people have no idea what they're looking at or how it even got to be. So we decided to, with the good wishes of the fair board, to do another little steam and power show right next to the antique building at the Minidoka County Fairgrounds.
Let me ask you this, Gary. I mean, what's the oldest piece of equipment, and what type of equipment is it that's going to be on display?
Well, we have about an 1890. It's called an Ireland shingle mill. It's one of those that made shingles like you see on the roof.
Really?
And then we have about an 1890s Ann Arbor hay press. It's a stationary baler, and it's run by a steam tractor and belts, and you throw the hay on, and it gives you, it's a hand-tied bale thing. So this is all pre-1900 machinery that was used then, and lots of little steam engines, huffers and puffers, you know, that they chug along and then all of a sudden let off a little steam. But those are what we're going to have. We have an advanced thrashing machine.
Mm-hmm.
This is really spectacular. It was in the parade, and it's all wood construction. It's a 32-inch cylinder, and it'll be run by an advanced traction engine, 2266, and that
Wow.
was manufactured in 1919.
Wow.
And so it has 22 horsepower on the drawbar and 66 horsepower on the belt, and it was originally used to power a sawmill. So those will all be on display, and they will be running. And so we'll have, we also have a grist mill that is going to be on display, and we're going to, it's one of those, it's about 1880, and it will be pulled or pushed by a one horse or a mule. We're going to have it there for on Wednesday, which would go around in a big circle and grind like the grist mill thing.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll have that on display, and then we have a little water pump with a one and a quarter horsepower engine pump jack, and then a great little washing machine that's run by a small engine, and it then has a wooden wash tub and an agitator in it that goes back and forth, run with this belt and this gas engine. It's really quite cute, really kind of neat.
You know, and in my case, I'm an agitator that doesn't need a belt. I just do it all by myself.
Well, you're in luck because we have an extra space available, and we're going to put you right on the pedestal. You're in. You're on.
Hey, let me ask you this, and I don't mean to paint you into a corner, but I got to find this out. When was, or what year, was the date of the first baling machine?
You've got me, and I'll have to get back to you tomorrow.
Okay, do that. Let me know. But, you know, have you ever saw...
sailing machine. I do not know that.
Okay, well, the reason I asked...
At least back by 1880, because they've got this stationary one.
Yeah. Well, the reason I asked that question, and I'm sure that you are, with the historical value of all the things you've written about and everything, you probably noticed this. You know, a lot of times in the movies, on TV, the old Western movies, like in the movie with Glenn Ford and Jack Lemmon called Cowboy, they get to the Chicago stockyards, and there are tons and tons and tons and tons of baled hay, but that supposedly took place in 1873. Not going to happen, did it?
I'm not so sure about that, because if we have an 1880 stationary baler here, it's now they either made a big mistake in the movies, or it was one of the very first hay bales that was hand-tied. So the automatic hand-tied bales didn't come until much later with wire and strong.
Okay.
So I understand that the first balers were about 1872, and you want to know how I pulled that out of the air?
Yeah, I'm really curious, because I thought I heard somebody in the background.
His name is Wheel.
Uh-huh.
On the internet, and he found it.
Okay.
So if it's 1873, I guess the movie's correct.
Oh, my goodness sakes. Okay, but now, here's a question of your studies and looking at this equipment. Gary, you know, from the caveman discovering fire to making a hammer, whatever it is, doesn't it just blow your mind how mankind has looked at something and said, oh, let's make a baler? I mean, that's amazing how they came up with the technocracy and the technology.
Well, these guys, when you're working in the field and you're working with a scythe and lobbing down your hay or the grass or whatever it is, and then you're putting it into a shock, which is a little round hill of that. Maybe people don't know a shock. But you take the, a fork, and then you put it on a wagon, and then you take it to a stack and this and that, and then there's always somebody had to think there had to be a better way. But technology was also growing. And so when they saw certain things of compression and this and that that was used in another way, they might have thought, well, why doesn't it work for hay, too, for a baler?
Yeah, we've got a caller with a question for you, Gary. And caller, go ahead. You're on the air, please.
Yes, good morning. I'd like to make a comment about Gary. You know, he's written some books, and I've read a few of them, and I'll tell you what, that guy is knowledgeable, and he's good about putting his facts down. And I know you're talking about the Minidoka County Fair, and I heard you giving a brief description of it, but I think you missed the Lion's Barbecue.
Well, I am sorry if I did, but I know that you being a lion, you will correct me and chastise me.
Well, I'm not going to chastise you, because I was in the shower when I heard it, and I probably was all wet, but it is coming up this Wednesday, not today, but, you know, next week.
Okay.
And it is from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. at the Rupert Fairgrounds. And we've done this for years. And we've elected to do it again. It's a fight for us because we're down on membership. But we will be out there. I will be there from 9 in the morning till probably midnight, trying to cook that and get it going. And, you know, there's others that cook it. There are several of us, and several of us that set it up and make it work. It's a big project for us. But I'd hate people not to know we're having it and not show up.
All right, Jerry, I appreciate it. And it's Wednesday night next week, and that's at the Minidoka County Fairgrounds. Thank you for your call. I appreciate it.
30 to 7:30.
All right, sir. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Selling tickets up front about an hour before, if they want to get in, get their ticket early.
Okay.
And if they want them, I've got them in my possession. I'll be glad to sell them some.
All right, buddy. Thank you for your call. Go back and get in the shower.
Something?
Yes, go ahead, Gary.
Something to Jerry?
Yeah, go ahead.
Are you selling?
Yes.
Are you selling corn during the week?
Are we selling corn?
Yeah.
Not. We
at,
won't.
At
we are
Lions.
Only doing the barbecue.
Oh.
The Lady Lions. I'm not sure whether they're selling corn or not. I haven't heard.
Well, I was just going to give you a pitch. Go get a cob of corn and come over and look at the Stephen Power Show.
Okay.
And we will have corn.
Was that a good
at the
segue?
Barbecue. and, you know, roast beef and roast pork, coleslaw, baked beans, and rolls.
Okay.
And so it's always a good feed. We've always fed a lot of people. A lot of people look forward to it and enjoy it.
All right, Jerry, thank you for your call, man. I'll be over there, I promise. Sounds good to me. Thank you.
Well, by gosh, we'll be looking for you.
All right, my friend.
Don't you fall down.
All right. God bless you, Jerry. Thank you.
You bet. Have a great day.
All right. Bye. We're on the phone with Gary Shoresman talking about the old equipment at the Minidoka County Fair. Gary, when you're talking about the 1880s, and you're talking about the 1890s, and you talk about the machinists and the making of this equipment and the different processing and manufacturing companies, it must amaze you how they built these old machines and really how well they worked.
They worked fabulously, and it was great technology, and that's what a free society in America offered, was that if you could think of it, you could build it, and you could sell it if it worked. Great. So kind of like the mousetrap thing. But when you look at some of those early plows and those early harrows and discs and hay derricks, and when they were building the Minidoka Dam in 1904, they had a boom and a swivel cog that they swung around hauling everything, and the cement. We have a cement mixer. It's a dandy cement mixer, and it will mix the concrete used in construction of the Minidoka project, Minidoka Dam. It'll be powered by a steam engine, and so here it's mixed, and then it's poured into wheelbarrows that's pushed by one man, one right after another, and that's how they laid a lot of that cement for the Minidoka Dam.
Oh my goodness, we've got
super intensive, but the mixer was there, and then you know later on you got the transport. Things are a little different.
Absolutely, we've got another caller with a question. Go ahead, caller. You're on the air. Thank you.
Hi, Gary and Zip. You know, I have one question. In 1959, I went to work for the John Deere dealer here in Burley. And one of the most fascinating inventions there was the knotting system on a hay baler. Do you agree with that?
Oh, yeah, because that's when I was a junior in high school, and one of my jobs was to haul hay. So it was quite a nice new invention. And I can always remember that little twisted two pieces of metal around that was called the knotter that really actually made the knot and then cut it and then shoved it out, and it was string, not wire. It was quite wonderful.
Yeah, it's had nothing to do with electronics or anything, just plain ingenuity.
Absolutely.
And at that time, John Deere was the best. I'm not just being biased with the truth, but they had the best knotter system on the planet that I know of.
Well,
we had one guy that worked there that did nothing but balers, and that was really a great innovation, I think, that John Deere had there.
Well, you're going to stop out to the fair, because we're going to have that hay baler that is stationary, and come and check it out, and we may get it running, get some hay in it, and watch it, how it packs.
Sounds good.
And how it ties.
All right, Keith, thank you very much for your call. I appreciate it. Gary, how did you go about finding all this equipment, and does it amaze you that there is still some of that old farm equipment not only left around, but still some of it in working order?
Well, I didn't find it. John Remsburg did, and he's traveled all over the United States, and I don't know about Canada, but he's traveled all over. When he finds something interesting and something totally different, that piques his curiosity, he goes and is able to, through the years of good hard work, has the ability to purchase some of these things and bring them back and then really go at restoring them. John can do cast iron on the front of a steam engine. He can do copper brazing. He can do brass. He can do all of this kind of thing, and actually, if a part is broken, remanufacture it on these pieces.
Wow.
And put different starting things on them, ignition things, meaning like with the belts and getting those all right. So it's not just running a tractor up and throwing a belt on. Everything has to be aligned correctly. But John knows all of this, and he's my age group, and he just learned it along the way. But his passion is fixing it so that, yes, someone younger can see how things worked and how great our country was and still is, and by showing these off. So John has a huge collection. We're probably going to have about 30 different outfits.
Oh, my. Now, did these old pieces of machinery, when they were produced, and I'm assuming that they had, quote-unquote, kind of an assembly line-type atmosphere to where they could mass-produce balers or whatever it might be, did they come complete to the distributor with a kind of a manual on how to operate them, or did they do that type of thing back in the 1800s and 1900s?
Well, I suppose they had some sort of direction, but one thing that I found curious was about automobiles when they first hit Rupert around 1910, as they came on a rail car, but they were packaged like on pallets.
Oh, my.
So they had to be, cars had to be put together at first, Model A's, Model T's.
Oh, my.
And then later on, when assembly lines changed, but originally these, you know, we had a huge steel manufacturing system in the United States at one time, and all these companies got together and they made these huge wheels, made all the mechanisms for the small engines and for like the steam engine and the thrashing machines and the steamroller that was in the parade this year. It's just quite amazing how they were capable of doing that. And the men, see, they even had to melt the iron and pour it into casts to get the pieces you want. That's where you get this cast iron.
Yeah, yeah. Gary, and I don't mean to belittle the old machinery as compared to today, but I'm sure in many respects you'd agree with me that if OSHA would have been in effect back in the late 1800s, early 1900s, they wouldn't have let one of these pieces of machinery be used, would they?
No, we'd be back in the dark ages still, like some of the other countries are, living in tents and huts and tribes and this and that and whatever. But that was what's so great about America, was that it was alive and well, and it was people looking for freedom, not only from religion, but to producing anything and everything we need. And it reminds me of when my family first arrived here in the Dakota Territory in 1873. The railroad had just made it to Yankton, South Dakota. That's where it ended. And they moved out onto their homesteads, and now here there were no towns, no railroad. What do you think these people had? Each one had a trade in a section or two sections of land. So if you needed a master butcherer, if you needed a tinsmith, if you needed a farrier, if you needed a someone on anything, everybody had a trade, and so they didn't need a government. They didn't even need a town. All they needed was each other and the expertise that they brought with them.
Mm. The old days, in many respects, Gary, they were the better days, weren't they?
Well, they were, because people depended upon one another.
Yeah.
Today,
yeah.
When I moved back here 16 years ago, I used to know everybody on the 3-mile stretch to my farm to town, and you could stop in at any time and say, hi, how you doing, and then it was over with. But now you stop, they look at you like, who are you and what do you want, how long are you going to stay?
Yeah.
And so it's a different society and a different time, and it's a time that if you think too much about it, you kind of get lonely for.
Well, this power and steam old farm equipment, now, you and John and others, I mean, are you going to go out and bring it in, or do the owners bring it in? What are some of the farthest points of the compass that they're coming from?
They're all coming from John's place.
Oh, my goodness.
3 miles from Rupert. He
oh,
has
my.
Huge warehouses and storage that he has all of this stuff there. Larry Harper from Paul is going to bring the grist mill. Mike Christensen will bring some of his from his place. So we'll have everybody congregating at the fairground on Saturday when it gets hauled all out there. But John has a forklift. He has a daughter and a son-in-law who know how to jump up and down off those wagons and throw chains through and tighten things up. And he can bring that big, huge thrashing machine on his trailer. And the same with the steam engine. One trip after another, it's out there, and then he can move it around with his heister. And then we got some manpower. Steve Whiteside has volunteered and with a couple of guys are going to come out and help us Saturday morning.
Well, Gary, is this display that you're going to have on the old farm equipment, the power and the steam equipment, is this something that is going to grow in popularity and it's something that might be kind of a traveling road show that you and John might take to other county fairs, et cetera?
Sure. You want to go with us?
I'd love to go anywhere right now.
John and I are going to get out of town with this, but it's a great idea. So this is the way that we can offer something to the community and to the public. Is John has it, and I run the antique building, so that kind of covers the insurance and all the stuff that you kind of need, because to try to get on a road show, the government will just hassle you to death with money trying to get here and there in insurance. I don't know that we could afford it to put the show on anywhere else.
Wow. Any final thoughts on the Minidoka County Fair for this year coming up next week on August 1st through the 6th, and especially the old farm equipment? I got about a minute left.
Well, I think everyone should just come out and check the fair out. We're lucky to have a small little fair that we do. It's really hometown. Everybody's pretty friendly, and we have like the dinner on Wednesday night. We also have plenty of food booths. There's the things happening in the rodeo grounds and the fairgrounds. And, of course, you know, we've got all the horses, cows, sheep, chickens, and all that kind of old-fashioned stuff to go look at. It's fun just to take your time to do it. But don't forget the antique building. Bring something in that's 50 years or older. And see you there and just lay back and have a nice time and come and check out the old engines and look around and see who you know.
Oh, I tell you what, Gary, I wish you a lot of success with this great display at the Minidoka County Fair. And you have always been so cordial to this program to come and talk about history, et cetera. We've got to get you back even after the fair and talk about politics and history, et cetera. Thank you for being on the show this morning.
Lord, you don't want me on politics.
Oh, yes, we do.
Hey, thank you so much for asking, and Jerry for making his little spiel, and so we got it pretty well covered.
All right, Gary Shoresman, thank you, God bless you, and we'll see everybody at the Minidoka County Fair.
Amen and hallelujah.
All right, thank you very much. Right now, with that being said, Gary Shoresman, of course, a great spokesman, great organizer, and thank you, John, and all the other folks for helping put this display on. I got to get over there and see that. That'd be really interesting. We've got to get a weather forecast on here, and Wheels is going to have Gina come in here and provide us the weather.
Here's a look at your weather as we hit midweek. And honestly, weather's going to be pretty much the same as it has been, sunny and hot. Looking at a high of 95 for today, tonight, low of 58 tomorrow, sunny and 95. Pretty much the same for Friday. Saturday, more clouds will be moving into the area. We do have a slight chance of some thunder bumpers, possibly a rain shower, maybe even a lightning storm. And then looking at highs, possible triple digits for Saturday, overnight low in the mid-60s. Yesterday's high was 93, the overnight low was 53. That is your weather for Zebeth Rain.
Oh, Gina, thank you for the weather forecast. Now it's your turn. Come on, somebody give me a call at 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. While I'm waiting for your call, that I just know you're dialing. I can feel it. I can feel the vibrance. I want to remind you about your life insurance needs, your health insurance needs, retirement planning, employee benefits, all of this and more for you, your family, and your business at Cameron and Siemens Insurance, Highway 24 in Rupert. Number to call for an appointment, and do it. Do it. Don't put it off. 436-4424. That number again, 436-4424. Cameron and Siemens Insurance, dedicated and responsive to your needs. Call today. Cameron and Siemens Insurance, 436-4424. There you go. All right, your turn. Calls welcome, 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. I don't want to offend anybody that lives in town. I don't want to offend anybody that thinks maybe I'm showing partiality towards one segment of our society. But, you know, last night I was scanning the dial of the TV set after I heard Big Bubba speak about his wife Hillary. And I happened upon a channel called Ride TV, 248 on my station list. And they were having the Mini Bareback Riding World Championship. Basically what it was is kids maybe about the ages of 6 to 9 years old, 6 to 10 I think it was, compete in the bareback riding, a rodeo event, but it was on Shetland ponies. Okay, it was kind of a fun event to watch. Well, anyway, after they got done riding, they had a young lady that was going to interview these kids, and I was absolutely blown away with the yes, ma'am, no, ma'am, thank you, ma'am, and the politeness of these young people. And everyone was like the same. I mean, what did you think about your ride? Well, ma'am, I could have done this better. Thank you, ma'am. And it was very, very polite. Then, about 30 minutes later, I turned to another station, and they were interviewing on, I think it was ESPN 2 or 3, I'm not sure which one it was. And they were interviewing a probably Little League or the next branch up baseball team. And they had both white and black youngsters that they were interviewing. And the interviewer said something, they go, yeah, nah, I don't know. I don't know. Yeah, it was all right. It was just a completely different attitude, a completely different upbringing. And I've said for a long time on my program, and if you're offended, that's your problem, not mine, that the country and rural lifestyle and the politeness that has been kind of crammed into our heads at an early age, when, boy, these young kids, these young boys were interviewed, and yes, ma'am, no, ma'am, thank you, ma'am, and then the opposite, when they were interviewing some of these kids on that baseball, yeah, I guess it was all right, yeah. Just kind of a not very polite attitude. Have you ever noticed that, or is it just me? Give me a call, 436-2244, 1-866-927-4587. Here's the game plan. And old Wheels is sitting over there going, boy, Deanne's going to be mad at both of us. Yeah, I should have got up and stood up for a little bit at 9:30 on the bottom of the hour. The doctors have said, you must stand up and let the blood flow. I didn't do it. I got to stand up right now during the news. But after the news, we're going to have my dear, dear friend Jack Euler here in the studio. And then at 10:32, we're going to have the lovely lady that knows all about refugee problems, all about terrorist problems, and that's Brigitte Gabriel. So don't miss that. We got a whole bunch of things going on this next hour. Zeb at the Ranch, Wheels, take it away. I'm going to stand up. The music is playing. We paid the band for another day. Thank you very much, Wheels. And we're back on Zeb at the Ranch, brought to you by our major sponsor, your Magic Valley Les Schwab Tire Centers, all 7 locations serving you, along with some of our absolutely great advertisers like Western Way Services, always at your disposal. Call them, get on the route service, 734-6969. We are very blessed, I am, to have a dear friend that I've known for, Jack, how long has it been? Over 20 years, hasn't it? My goodness. And he used to be the main man helping us with our production of our television show that Johnny, you and I used to have called Cowboy Country. And if it wasn't for Jack, that show would have not been produced. And now here he is, a leader that has absolutely stood up in front of the whole state and said, I will help you fight the environmentalists and the wolf lovers. And he's done a great job with that. Jack Euler, good morning. Good to have you on the program.
Glad to be here, Zeb.
Well, you're always welcome on the show. Jack, I get criticized a lot on this program. Some people say that I'm fear-mongering and going into different topics that, oh, it'll never happen, don't worry about it. But, you know, little by little, and we've talked about this in programs past, we are seeing more legislation. We are seeing more regulation. We are seeing more of that seven-letter word control when it comes to us, the American citizens, being able to use our public lands. How would you respond? Am I being a fear-monger?
No, you're not. Anything that you hear about public lands is something that's been leaked out by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, by BLM, by Forest Service, or by somebody in these organizations. They want this information to get out because it deals with when they put their proposals out, then they can... people will have an opinion, and maybe they will get back to them on their proposals.
Okay, but now we're hearing things about the closures of trails. We're hearing things about the closures of certain areas. We're hearing things about grazing being cut back. We're hearing things about people with the four-wheelers, the side-by-sides, etc., maybe having some new regulations. What have you found out?
I want to talk today a little bit about that. I also want to touch on the wolf issue, because I got a call from the University of Idaho on that.
Good.
But I've been dealing with this closure on a weight limit on off-road vehicles and with some of the dealers that sell off-road vehicles. And there is a proposal out there that if the vehicle weighs more than 850 pounds, it cannot be used on public lands. It cannot be used on public lands if it's over 50 inches wide. If it's made outside of the United States, it can't be over 606 pounds.
Now this is
dry weight.
Okay.
Now dry weight is the weight of the unit when it is shipped in the crate or box from the manufacturer.
Okay. Let's talk a little bit about what this would do to that industry. Number one, the side-by-sides are now the rage.
And
even the 4x4s are the rage. And what supposed damage are the environmentalists that are probably behind this, and also the BLM Forest Service, etc., what supposed damage are they doing?
It's going to damage the industry within the United States.
No, I mean as far as to the land itself.
It's not going to do anything, because there's regulations. The states have regulations that these vehicles have to be on roads.
Right.
And as long as they're on the roads, then there's no damage. There's no damage to anything. But this is a way to eliminate commerce in the United States.
Control.
Yes, control.
Yeah.
It's total control by somebody in Washington, D.C., by the environmental groups, by whomever.
Jack, who started this movement?
Environmentalists.
Really?
Sure. They do not sleep. And that's why I said I want to talk to you a little bit about the wolf issue, because there's things going on that shouldn't be going on.
Well, let me ask a couple more questions about the four-wheelers and the side-by-sides, etc. This is an industry that has really grown in popularity, and most people that are on four-wheelers and side-by-sides really appreciate and respect Mother Nature as far as getting out in the hills, staying on the trails, etc. So, basically, economically, this would really be a hindrance, not only for the state of Idaho, but all across the United States, by trying to stop an industry of recreation.
That is completely true. And the environmental groups know that these people that are on these units and the recreationists, they're cleaning trails as they go also. And they always have done. People on horses clean trails. And all industries clean trails when they go off-road. But the things and the environmental groups do not want us on public lands.
How far advanced is this proposed legislation? What do you know about where it's going, who started it, where it is in the House, or whatever?
Well, I know it is an environmental group that started it, and I know that it is proposed through the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, which is over BLM and Forest Service, and the Interior Department in Washington, D.C.
Jack, in your opinion, and you've been an outdoorsman all your life, I mean, you've been with hunters, sportsmen for Fish and Wildlife, you've been a hunter and avid fisherman and everything, what, looking into the crystal ball, if they started to have that regulation with a certain aspect of the four-wheeling and the side-by-side industry, eventually hoping to curtail it in its entirety, wow, what would that do to the economy?
It's going to kill that part of the economy. And the economy, I mean, gas, fuel for these units, everything. You know, it just keeps going.
All the supplies and
all
the accessories, everything.
And selling recreational equipment to go camping, it's going to have a big impact on the economy.
What of the people that you've talked to, are they really concerned, or are they going, they'll never pass that legislation? What's the attitude?
Dealers are very concerned, because I have talked to dealers about this, and I got these figures from a dealer.
I see. So basically, it's not just a flash in the pan. These environmental groups are really going to make a concentrated effort.
That's right. And, you know, I have been on committees with environmental groups, and my question always is, what have you done on the ground? How much money have you spent on the ground as an environmental group to better a species? Because it's always been a species that I've been dealing with, whether it be sage grouse or wolves, but their answer, this is their answer. We have not put money on the ground because we would rather spend the money on courts and attorneys.
You know, Jack, I'm really highly offended by these environmental groups, and I'd be more than happy if you want to line somebody up from one of those groups to come talk to me. I'd love it. But, you know, really, with my handicaps and my physical disabilities, I can either use on public land my horse or a four-wheeler. And you know as well as we're looking at each other right now, there are groups and insidious members of those groups that want to cancel my right to see my public lands.
That's right. And you know how years ago, I think it was the Sierra Club, you and I tried to get on the radio.
They were very cowardly.
And they finally backed out and would not come on the radio with us.
You know, for those folks in the audience that aren't aware of the conversation, we had some people from the Sierra Club call and condemn me and damn me and everything, and Jack and I said, okay, come on the air. Well, about 2 or 3 days later, they sent a little note, and they said, well, we'll come on your radio program, but you will have to get somebody else to be a mediator. They wouldn't let me run my own program, and they said they had to have exactly the same numbers and everything else. They're cowards is basically what they are.
And they had to have the questions up front.
Yeah, right. And I won't do that. Now, we have a caller with a quick question, and then I want to talk to you about the wolves a little bit. Caller, go ahead. You're on the air.
Yeah, I just want to make one comment. I had a chance to visit with Jack at some length one day, and I find out he is not paid by any association or anything. These wonderful things he does for us, it's done at his own expense, and he is the greatest as far as I'm concerned, because he really cares about America and our environment.
You know, and I appreciate that, Keith, and I'm going to hurry along because we've only got a short time, but I'll relay that to him. Thank you so much for your phone call. Jack, it was just one of many people, and that was Keith Cottom. And he said that you have done this out of the goodness of your heart and your love for the great outdoors, and nobody's handing you a big paycheck.
Nobody's handing me anything.
I know that. But, you know, again, I'll reiterate, without you, and without your efforts, what are we going to do when all of a sudden you decide to sit in the geezer chair and say that's enough?
I've told this to these dealerships, and the reason I tell the story now is because of my good friend Grant Gerber,
right,
and the loss of Grant Gerber and what that meant. And it bothers me that one day, and it could be quick, I won't be here.
Don't you even intimate that you're not going to be here. I hope you are giving me a hard time for 20 more years. I hope I'm here for 20 more years. Let's get to the wolf situation. Now, there's been some new news regarding what's going on with the enviros, the animal huggers, and everything else with the wolves. What's going on?
Well, for people that don't know, when the wolves were introduced into Idaho, Montana, and Wyoming, there were regulations set as to what was considered recovered.
Yeah.
And it was 10 breeding pair or 100 wolves in each state.
Right.
So,
and that's your cell phone, not mine. I love big radio on TV. Whatever.
Anyway, and then when we did the state management plans, the state management plans went from 15 breeding pair to 150. And today we have like 126 breeding pair in the state of Idaho, and we got about 1,000 wolves.
Okay.
Three environmental groups have filed suit to increase the numbers, and they say the states, and to take the management of wolves away from the states and give it back to the government and let the government do it.
Okay, stop. Wait a minute. We have an agreement that's signed, right?
We did.
15 breeding pair and 150 wolves.
Right.
Now, if we're at, and most of the experts that I've had on this program, including yourself, say that we are at a minimum, but we'll use the figure of 1,000 wolves. So we are almost 10 times over the numbers that were allocated in that agreement. So what's the beef?
They do not stop. This is the beef. They do not stop. The environmental groups, they just keep pushing and pushing and pushing. And when we have hunting seasons on wolves like we do, and it's a management tool, just like it's a management tool for elk and deer and whatever, and we have shown the government that that we could do this by having this for 5 years, and now they are coming back and saying, no, the state of Idaho or these other states can't do it. The government needs to do it.
Okay, now
they're trying to take again the control away from the state and give it back to the government.
Okay, now let me ask specifics here. When you say control away from the states, we're talking primarily they want to take away any power or any management from the Idaho Fish and Game.
Yes.
Okay. Is that the same in Wyoming and Montana?
Yes.
Okay. Now, have those states, our neighbor states of Montana and Wyoming, according to the people I know in those states, their numbers also have far exceeded the agreement?
That's right.
All right. So where is the power? Where are the senators? Where are the congressmen? Where are the people as our leadership? Why aren't they standing up to these environmental groups and saying, hit the road, Jack? We've honored the commitment.
Why haven't they said that in a lot of things in Washington, D.C.? I get so uptight at some of the things that go on there because I've been there and I've watched.
So they're not representing us?
No. And, I mean, this, the when this, we had 5 years to prove the state of Idaho and Wyoming and Montana that we could manage wolves,
which we did,
to the numbers,
which we did.
But do you know what hasn't been passed from the government back to us? They haven't given us a piece of paper that says you guys are in charge. You have shown us that you can manage them. And the environmentalists say, we feel that the states can't manage them in the right way, so we're going to go back on it.
What is it going to take, honestly, if you had a magic wand today, what is it going to take to stop this absolutely insidious and evil movement by the environmentalists and say, wait a minute, the numbers here in Idaho are almost 10 times the agreement. Okay, Wyoming and Montana the same. So what's it going to take? What is it going to take? People to stand up and say enough is enough and throw these bums out of Dodge City? What do we need to do?
It needs to come from our congressman in Washington, D.C. I mean, Zeb, I'll tell you what the problem is, and it's money. And these environmental groups have tapped into the money supply in Washington, D.C., and which is our tax dollars.
That's right.
And that's what the problem is.
So basically these groups, and I'll just mention names, whether they're associated with it or not, I don't like them anyway, Sierra Club, Defenders of Wildlife, and all these other groups, they're saying they want unlimited and unfettered numbers.
That's right. That's what they want. I mean, they want Washington, D.C. in control. And that's what it amounts to.
And I would imagine...
And this professor from the University of Idaho that called me a week or so ago on this issue, and we talked about it for an hour and a half on the telephone.
And they don't want, I would assume, along with the unfettered numbers, they don't want any management.
That's right. It's just like you can't... In the Frank Church Wilderness area, the Idaho Fish and Game supposedly cannot land a helicopter or use a dart to dart an animal to put a collar on it to manage them, to follow them, because that's a mechanical device, and a mechanical device can't be used in the Frank Church Wilderness area.
Jack, do people really understand how severe this problem is? And what would happen, quickly, because we're only down to about 4 minutes, but in your opinion, if these environmentalists file a re-suit on the lawsuit for unfettered numbers, what would happen?
They've already filed.
Okay, but what happens if it's accepted?
well, they will keep going. They will move forward with another suit to get more and more and more.
And you can't blame one single rancher or one single homeowner that borders perhaps the forest or whatever if they haul out that 30-06 and start shooting every damn wolf that comes on their property.
You know, those ranchers don't know who protected their interest and gave them the opportunity to shoot a wolf.
That's right.
And Bert Stevenson and myself went to Boise and we talked in favor of the 10J rule. And we got the 10J rule through.
Explain that quickly.
The 10J rule gave, when the wolves were first here, the ranchers couldn't protect their own interests, their cattle, their sheep, their horses, whatever, their pets. And after we got the 10J rule through, yes, they could protect and they could shoot.
And it's safe to say that these environmentalists are nothing more than liars and charlatans that agreed to the 15-pack and 150-wolf ruling, and now they want to lie their way out of it and make it uncountable numbers. They just want to let the thing go.
I have sat at the table with these groups, and I have said, and I will say it again right now, that the only thing that you can count on with an environmental group, that the agreement that you make at the table will not be good after the meeting's over and the door's shut.
How do we? Okay, we've got a minute and a half left here, real quick. How do we fight these people? I mean, really, I'm open. I'll do anything I can to help you, but how do we fight these people?
I do not dare say it on the radio.
You just made me choke on my water.
How do you fight them? Zeb, you can't fight them legally because they will not adhere to regulations.
And they're using our tax dollars against us.
They are, day in and day out. And
Must be very frustrated.
I'm very frustrated, especially since I lost my comrade who did a lot of work on these issues in Elko.
What about Crapo? What about Labrador? What about Jim and the rest of these guys? Are they doing anything to stand up or just giving lip service?
They're giving lip service right now, but I can tell you, what is going to turn it around? It's going to be a change in administration.
That could be for the bad, though.
No, it's going to be for the good.
Even if Hillary gets in?
No.
Okay, that's what my point was.
Not her.
Okay.
A change from the
from
Democrats.
Obama. Yeah, there you go. You scared me there for a minute.
It's a change from the Democrats.
Okay, I've got about 30 seconds left. Jack, I want you to do me a favor and do some follow-up on this thing, especially with the ATVs. And let's do another program on this next week. I'll get a chance to do some follow-up. And then let's see if we can't get some phone numbers. And we'll call back our dear, beloved friends at the Sierra Club on the air and see if they want to talk to us. What about that?
They won't.
Okay. Jack Euler, God bless you. Thank you so much. You're always welcome on this show. A dear friend of mine and Deanne's, and a friend to all of us helping us. Jack Euler, thank you so much. We're going to send it back over to our main studios. We'll be back in about 3 minutes. Brigitte Gabriel will be on the phone. Thank you.
And now, back to Zeb at the Ranch on AM 1230 KBAR. To reach Zeb, call 436-2244 or toll-free 1-866-927-4587. And now, here is Zeb Bell.
A lot of guests that I have on this program, I absolutely hold them in the highest regard for their knowledge and their integrity of what they know about the subject matter they talk about on my show. This next lady, I have had the opportunity to meet, and she has been on my program many, many times, and I absolutely trust her, and I value her opinion and thoughts as to where we are in this country today with terrorism and the infiltration of ISIS and Al-Qaeda and the laxity of what's going on in our government. And I say a good morning to a dear friend, the president of ActForAmerica.org and author of They Must Be Stopped, Brigitte Gabriel. Good morning, Brigitte, my dear friend. How are you?
Oh, good morning, Zeb. With such an introduction, I can be with you every day you want.
Well, I value everything you say, and I honored the time that we spent up in Caldwell about a year ago when you spoke up in that area. And I guess my question would be first and foremost to you. The current refugee forced immigration into this country, and quite frankly, Brigitte, into this area of southern Idaho, the Twin Falls area, is becoming extremely wary to me, and I don't know who these people are. I don't know how to trust these people, and I certainly don't trust my government. What are your thoughts about this forced refugee immigration into America?
I have to tell you, it is frightening right now to see the speed by which they are bringing these refugees in. And the scary part is they are bringing them under the radar. We know that they are not vetted, at least not vetted the way they should be, obviously not according to the Obama vetting process. But here's the scary part, because we know it is the United Nations who is deciding on what type of refugees come to America. You see, it is the United Nations High Commission for Refugees that decides what refugees come to America. They work with the OIC, the Islamic the Organization on Islamic Cooperation. They are bringing refugees to America from four countries, basically: Somalia, Afghanistan, Iraq, and Syria. So the State Department then distributes these refugees to nine major federal contractors, six of them are supposedly religious contractors. These are the guys who are bringing these refugees to the communities. It's a money-making machine, and because of the money that is involved, they don't care about vetting them. They are trying to shove them down the throats of different communities across the nation, because these nine federal contractors, not only they are getting money from the U.S. Treasury to the point of $1 billion to resettle these refugees, but what they are, by the way, they are not doing it passing the dish on Sunday morning in their churches. Remember, six of these federal agencies are religious charities. But they have 350 subcontractors in different communities, including the communities in Idaho, which take these refugees. So for the first 6 months, they train the refugee on giving him or her all the benefits that they receive, and to top it off, you know, the health benefits, the educational benefits, this, that, and the other. But then once they start with that, once they do that for 6 months, then they start bringing, then they start filing the papers to bring the extended family of that refugee. So what you're looking right now at, you're not only looking at the refugees you have in Idaho, because if they've been there for 6 months, now they're already starting the papers to bring their extended family to Idaho. And you know where that's going to be leading to.
You know, Brigitte, our local newspaper, the Times News, our local college, the College of Southern Idaho, and even the city council in Twin Falls, many of their members have said that people like me that are worried and concerned about security, that we're bigots and we're hate mongers, and we should stop the hate. How would you respond? I'm very concerned for the safety and security of my family, and I'm certainly not a bigot.
Well, you are certainly, and many other patriots who are concerned about this issue are not bigots. We are basically concerned about the health of our communities. And those who are worried, that, let's remove the security issue apart. You know, obviously we are worried about security. But let's look at the health issues that these people are bringing. The side effect, not security. Let's discuss tuberculosis, for example, and the diseases these people are bringing to your community. By the way, tuberculosis, which was almost eradicated from the United States, is now on the rise nationwide because of the refugee population. Let's start in Idaho. You already have seven tuberculosis cases within the refugees who brought it to Idaho. Colorado, 16 cases. Ohio, 11 cases. Vermont, 35 cases. Wisconsin, 117 cases. Florida, 11 cases. Indiana, 4. Kentucky, 9. North Dakota, 4. And by the way, the Wisconsin cases and many others in different states, some of them are even drug resistant. So these refugees are bringing diseases to the United States right now. It's tuberculosis, which was almost eradicated, and now the cases are drug resistant. It takes about $150,000 per case to be treated, and it takes 6 to 8 months of those drug resistant cases. Let's look at that. Forget the security issue. Let's look at the health issue. Let's look at the rape issue. We already know the rise of the rape issue, what's happening in Europe with the refugee population. We have already seen cases in Minnesota, in Virginia. There was a case in Virginia where a rapist, a refugee who was in America for less than 4 weeks, already attempted sexual assault on a woman in Virginia. Look at the cases in Vermont. Look at what's happening in Minnesota, where refugees are walking down the street, Somali refugees, in middle-class to upper-class neighborhoods, screaming at ladies that they want to rape them. These are issues that are very concerning to us as citizens. This is not the type of refugees you want to bring. These are people who do not share our values and our respect for women, our respect for human rights, our respect for the Constitution. This is not the type of refugees you want to bring to the United States.
Brigitte, you have lived through terrorism, and you're here in this country trying to warn us and give a clarion call that, my goodness, we've got to stop this naivete, and we've got to start understanding how serious ISIS and Al-Qaeda are. In your opinion, why is this administration turning a deaf ear and a blind eye to a problem that's growing daily?
because remember, this administration called ISIS a JV team. So for him or this administration to admit that they made a grave mistake, and JV is not a refugee team, but as a matter of fact, they grew because of the lack of attention that was paid to them by the Obama administration, will be basically saying, I'm the one who endangered the world. I'm the one who gave the world ISIS. They cannot bring themselves to actually accept that reality. And this is why the Obama administration and all his minions right now are basically backtracking, you know, coming up with all sorts of things. Well, ISIS now, you know, like what John Kerry is saying, they are, they are contained. You know, we are winning this war. And, you know, it's what type of nonsense is this? What do they think? Do they think we are fools and we're not watching the news to see that ISIS is mushrooming worldwide and exploding worldwide, including here in the United States? We already know that we have ISIS already in 50 states that we know of. And this is according to the heads of our intelligence agencies.
You know, I watched the Democratic National Convention last night and the night before, and there was no mention of security. There was no mention of ISIS. There was no mention of better being prepared for a world that right now is like a powder keg. What is the matter with the Democratic Party in this country right now, Brigitte, that they seem to want to put this problem under the rug and not acknowledge it?
Because again, it will be acknowledging defeat. It will be acknowledging that under their watch, the world is a more dangerous place. And let's not forget that the front runner right now, the candidate for president for the Democratic Party, is the person who's under her watch. Libya is now in shambles. Iraq is in shambles. Syria is in shambles. Yemen is in shambles. The world is falling apart. And this is the person who's under her watch is basically this happened. And this is the person who's running for president of the United States. This is the weakest point of the Democratic Party right now, and that's the reason why they are shying away from this subject. They do not want to tackle it. They do not want to talk about it, because to talk about it will be an admission that under this leadership for the last 8 years, America basically is dragging the world into war, because America has forgotten a problem and not paid attention and dealt swiftly with the disease that we knew was there, we knew was growing, but we underestimated and miscalculated the disease. And it is solely lays at the feet of President Obama and Secretary of State Hillary Clinton.
You know, when you look at the news every day and you hear the news reports on television and radio about ISIS with a bomb here blowing up people, then we hear about the mass shootings, and then we hear about two teenage ISIS recruits going into a Catholic church in France and slitting the throat of a priest. My God, Brigitte, this thing is completely out of control, but I don't see any leadership in this country.
Exactly. That we are lacking the leadership in this country, Zeb, and this is exactly why we at Act for America are trying everything we can to mobilize the nation and speak sense into our elected officials to understand that national security is the most important issue. This is the job of the government, to secure the lives of the people, to secure the communities of the people. And Act for America, my organization, is holding a national security conference in Washington, D.C. this upcoming week of September 11th, on the September 6th and 7th, to remind our elected officials that their number one job is to secure and protect America and Americans. And right now, they are not doing their job correctly. They need to pay attention to this problem. We need to make sure America is leading in this world. We need to make sure we deal swiftly with any ISIS operatives operating within our own country. And I encourage our listeners to go to our website, actforamerica.org, and join us. Find more information. We are the largest national security organization in America. We are the NRA of national security. We have chapters nationwide, and we want you to join us. Go to actforamerica.org and get involved.
Brigitte, when you pick up the newspaper every day and you see headlines like in the USA Today, "Don't judge Muslims too harshly," or "We should be more kind and loving and then they will respond in kind," what are your thoughts?
Oh, we already were kind. We already showed them love and respect. I mean, let's start with September 11th right here. The 19 hijackers who perpetrated a horrible act of murder and barbarism against Americans were all welcomed into our countries by visas given to them in our embassies. They learned how to fly in American flight schools by teachers who were kind to them to teach them. They lived in America. They had American driver's licenses. They paid with American dollars for their flight lessons. We showed them how kind we are. We showed them how welcoming we are. Where did that get us? We've been doing that for the last 15 years. Where did that get us? It's not a matter that they do not like our kindness. It's not a matter that if we show them more kindness, they'll be nice to us. They hate us and they hate our guts because they are on a personal jihad against the United States. The sooner we realize and recognize that and come to grips with it, the sooner we can protect our population and save our country and protect our freedom.
You know, Hillary has come out and said that she wants to double, triple, and maybe even quadruple the numbers of refugees coming in from Syria, etc., into the United States. But what power do we have? What power do we have to tell our governors? What power do we have to tell our local leaders? No, enough is enough until we get a vetting process. We don't seem to have any power in our own country.
Well, yeah, the power is in the hands of the people, Zeb. This is the most amazing thing about America. We are a nation made for the people, by the people. This is what is so wonderful. The problem is people don't make their voice heard to their elected officials. And I ask our listeners, when was last time you called your governor and told him or her, no refugees in my state? When was last time you called your city mayor, your mayor, and told him or her, you better not bring any refugees to my city or your tush will be fired next time there's an election? When was last time you showed up to city council meeting and told them, we're going to de-elect and throw you all out unless you do what is right by our community and protecting our communities? The problem is that people don't take action. They listen to talk radio, they listen to television and get frustrated, but they're not taking action. Few do, but most do not do anything. And this is why it's important for people to know the power of their phone call, the power of their voice. And here's an example I want to share with you. I talk to people all the time, and I tell them, how many people do you need to hear from to make an issue your top priority? You will be shocked. On the federal level, for congressmen and senators, they need to hear from 40 to 50 people. That's it. On a local level, they need to hear from 10 to 15 people. That's it. And here's the science behind the numbers. They believe that every phone call or a letter are representative of 1,000 people, because they believe if one person makes a phone call or a letter, he or she are representing 1,000 couch potatoes who feel the same way, but they don't take any action, yet they vote on election day. That represents 40 to 50,000 voters. That's how powerful your voice is. So for those of you who are listening to me right now, I encourage you to go to our website, actforamerica.org. If you're concerned about the refugee population, sign up and join our refugee resettlement working group. You will be notified of bills coming down for a vote, so you can call your elected official and tell them how to vote on it. You will be empowered by information regarding your local community, so you can call your mayor, your city council, your lieutenant governor, or your elected officials and tell them what you need to tell them in order to protect your community. That's how we're going to be able to take our country back.
Now, Brigitte, you're going to be here in this area of southern Idaho on August 4th at 7 p.m. at the Roper Auditorium on Filer Avenue in Twin Falls. And I want to say this up front. I am so saddened that I can't be there to see you again. I just got out of the hospital from major surgery, and I'm going to have to say over the radio, God bless you, and I hope your message is well heard that evening. But what are some of the topics you're going to talk about in Twin Falls that night?
Oh, well, I'm sorry I'm going to miss you, and I'm sorry to hear about your surgery. But it's going to be a very informative event. It's going to be passionate. Obviously, we're talking about a very passionate issue. And it's going to light a fire under people. It's going to be about patriotism. It's going to be about how we, the people, can take back our communities, can take back our country. I'm going to give tips about what's happening with the refugee population in Idaho. I'm going to give tips about what's happening with the refugee population nationwide. I'm going to talk about legislation we are working on with members of Congress to block Obama from bringing more refugees into the country. I'm going to talk about ISIS in the United States, what we can do as citizens, the warning signs in a community, how you can spot a terrorist, and how we can protect our country together. So these will be the topics I will be discussing in detail, and I hope that you come, you bring a friend. Any of you who are listening right now, bring as many people as possible. We need to come together to protect the nation.
This is a wonderful lady, a very sincere and honest and very well-versed lady, and she is the president of ActForAmerica.org and the author of They Must Be Stopped and also Because They Hate, my friend Brigitte Gabriel. Brigitte, God bless you, the very best to you, and I certainly hope you'll come back on the program soon.
Thank you. I'll be delighted, Deb. Take care.
All right. Thank you very much. I love that lady. She is very dynamic and so knowledgeable about the problem. And I'm just going to say this, and this might offend some people. I certainly hope that the Times News, I certainly hope that the members of the College of Southern Idaho Refugee Center, and I certainly hope members of the Twin Falls City Council have the backbone to attend this meeting and listen to her, because she knows far, far more about the problem than they do. That's going to be at August 4th at 7 p.m. at the Roper Auditorium on Filer Avenue in Twin Falls. Brigitte Gabriel, my friend. Oh, we got to get the weather forecast in here. And the weather is brought to everybody by Scarrow's Meats, 331 North Road, Jerome. The number to call, 324-7657. You know, it is time to maybe clean out the freezer. Maybe you've got some wild game in the freezer that they, Scarrow's Meats, can make into salami or pressed jerky or pepperoni sticks. And you better call them today, 324-7657. Scarrow's Meats, they are changing the way we eat, one delicious bite at a time. Right now, here's the weather with Gina.
Here's a look at your weather as we hit midweek. And honestly, weather's going to be pretty much the same as it has been, sunny and hot. Looking at a high of 95 for today, tonight, low of 58 tomorrow, sunny and 95. Pretty much the same for Friday. Saturday, more clouds will be moving into the area. We do have a slight chance of some thunder bumpers, possibly a rain shower, maybe even a lightning storm. And then looking at highs, possible triple digits for Saturday, overnight low in the mid-60s. Yesterday's high was 93. The overnight low was 53. That is your weather for Zebra
Rain. Gina, thank you. Brought to you by your hometown meat cutter. Locally owned and custom meat processor for over 20 years, Scarrow's Meats. 331 North Road, Jerome. The number to call, 324-7657. They are changing the way we eat, one delicious bite at a time. Let's not make any excuse here or not try to cover up some of the verbiage. I don't want the refugees here in southern Idaho, especially those from Syria or any from that war-torn part of the world. Germany, France, etc. Europe is a mess right now because there is not a vetting process and they don't know who these people are. And you and I and others are being lied to when people say, oh, the vetting process, they know all about these. No, they don't. They haven't got computer records. They don't have jack bananas about who these people are. And I really hope, and I mean this and I'm saying it forcefully, that the Times News, College of Southern Idaho, Twin Falls City Council, and other leaders attend that meeting on the 4th with Brigitte Gabriel. Open your eyes, open your ears, and understand what the problem really is. While I have a moment, I also want to say thank you to our major sponsor, and that's, of course, your Magic Valley Les Schwab Tire Center. Some summer travel time, and they've got many of their best-selling tires on sale. Listen to this. The Eclipse tire is on sale right now. All-season traction, smooth, quiet ride. It's on sale for your passenger cars. And here's another one. The Courser STR LTR tire on sale now. All-season tread, attractive styling, all the different best tread designs to get you the best in safe driving. All of these at your Magic Valley Les Schwab Tire Centers. The best in brake service, you know that. And the best in front-end alignments and shocks and struts and batteries, but the best in service. They literally run right out the front door and say, can we help you? Yes, you may. Well, I'll tell you what, you stop in and see Lane and Rupert, Dave on Blue Lakes and Twin, Mike and Buell, Mike and Jerome, the Twist family and Paul, Daniel on Poline in Twin Falls, and Randy on Overland in Burley. The best, your Magic Valley Les Schwab Tire Centers, serving you. Tomorrow is Thursday, and that is a busy, busy day. We're going to have the Chamber of Commerce report. We're going to have Dog Nation. We're going to have Rita Ramsey starving to death, and we're going to have our business salute. And we're also going to have Sharon Hardy Mills. Sharon Hardy Mills is going to be on the program talking about how she's going to relive what her great, I think I said that enough, grandmother did, pulling and pushing a handcart across America to get here to the Intermountain West. And she's going to be doing the same thing to relive the experiences. So that should be kind of interesting to talk to her about that tomorrow at 10:30. I hope you enjoyed the program. I hope you'll call in tomorrow morning, because we will be here bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. Well, somewhat, at 8:06 in the morning and go till 11, Zebeth Ranch, and of course right here on KBAR 1230 and streaming live on the internet all over the universe at zebbell.com. And I want to leave you with this, and it's true. The way things were are the way things ought to be. God bless you and your family. We'll see you tomorrow morning at 8:06.